Hello, everyone. So here's where I want to start. A certain portion of the population will be physically impacted by COVID-19. But every single person is going to be and is emotionally impacted and psychologically impacted by COVID-19. So the pandemic is a health pandemic, but it is even more so a mental health pandemic. Now, there are four considerations you need to have going forward in understanding what the population at large is going through with this pandemic. And then there's one complication, because those four won't be enough, so I'll have to add one more complication at the end. But I want to start with four considerations that you really have to take in mind in terms of what the mental health and emotional health state of people is going to be truly now, and as we go forward in time with COVID-19, as we even come out and start to emerge from this, where people are going to be psychologically and emotionally, because the impact of COVID-19 has been profound. I'm going to start with the most basic thing of all, and that is anxiety. Now, anxiety is considered a mental disorder when it reaches certain levels and impairs functioning in a certain way. But in fact, it doesn't take a mental health disorder of anxiety, an anxiety disorder, to really impact our functioning, because most of us have and will experience bursts and any kind of daily anxiety during this pandemic. It doesn't rise necessarily to the level of an anxiety disorder. For some, it will, but we all experience it. And the problem with anxiety is it's extremely disruptive. It's disruptive to our quality of life, but more importantly, it's disruptive to our thinking, to our decision making, to our judgment, and to our behavior. Anxiety is defined by a vague feeling of dread. In the absence of an immediate threat, as it were. Now, after months of working from home and quarantine and self-distancing, after months of training ourselves to stay 6 feet apart from people, to wear gloves and masks when we are in public, to not touch surfaces, to try and avoid touching our face, we have trained our mind to be really anxious and worried about human contact. And when easing will come and when life will start to resume in whatever the new normal will be, that is not something that you can just undo with a snap of the fingers. Because when you train your mind to be careful and cautious and anxious about something, that remains. And we're already seeing it. We're already seeing it in people who are struggling to return to work when they're asked to return to work because they're highly anxious about leaving their homes. And these are people who might have felt very, you know, upset about having to work from home, but at this point, home feels safe and it's secure. And so to venture out into the workplace, into the world, truly even to get their mail, can seem scary for a lot of people and is scary for a lot of people. So we're going to see all kinds of surges in anxiety that people experience as easing happens. The more we move toward normalcy, the more anxiety is likely to erupt, and the more people are likely to experience a real hesitance and inhibition from doing things they did previously, going to stores, going to the office, interacting with people in all kinds of ways. This is something that you have to be aware of that is going to be operating with people. So anxiety is the first thing. The second thing that people are dealing with is loss and grief. And when I say loss and grief, I don't just mean those very unfortunate people who've lost people to COVID-19 or to other events that have happened over this time. But in a way, we have all sustained profound losses over these past months. We have lost our way of life, primarily. Even if we're starting to get it back a little bit, we've still lost a significant, significant portion of it. We have lost our ability to plan. We have lost our ability to engage in celebrations and rituals like weddings and birthdays and anniversaries and funerals. These things have been going on. We just haven't been able to do them in the way we traditionally would. we have lost our independence because we are now housebound, or we are very limited in how far we can go, where we can go, what we can do. We've lost our ability to have vacations, in certain places, go to restaurants, do all the leisure, relaxing activities that we typically work so hard to be able to afford to do. So the losses are many, and people experience this vague feeling of loss and grief all the time. And most people don't put their finger necessarily on the fact that that's what they're feeling, but that is what they're feeling. They're grieving the loss of a way of life that, as we know, may not come back to how it was either ever or not very soon. It might be years before life truly resumes in the way it had before. That is a profound disruption. It's the biggest disruption we've experienced truly since World War II. And there are very few people alive today who are old enough to remember and experience that level of disruption. So this is new, this is dramatic. And people, as human beings, we respond to those kinds of dramatic events and the losses that we have by, in a very fundamental way, it impacts us. We grieve, even if we're not aware that we're grieving. The thing about loss, the thing about grieving, the thing about emotional distress is that we have a finite amount of emotional and intellectual resources that we have on a daily basis to do our jobs, to function, to live. And emotional distress, and certainly loss, certainly grief, anxiety as well, take up a significant proportion of our bandwidth in that way, leaving us less left with to function in our jobs. The more loss and grieving we experience, even if we're not aware of it, the more anxiety we have, the more likely we are to make mistakes, simple ones, silly ones, or not so simple ones, because we're just not fully present. And every one of us is not fully present right now, given all the stresses that we've been under these past few months. Which leads me to the next thing that we need to address, and this perhaps is the most serious, and that is loneliness. Now, loneliness is defined purely subjectively. It depends solely on whether you feel emotionally connected to the people around you, whether you feel seen, appreciated, a part of those people around you. And I say that because the research shows that over 60-something percent of people who report being lonely, this is pre-COVID, were actually living with a partner or with a family. That is not a guarantee in any way that you might not be lonely. Why loneliness is important, it's something that's been spoken about for a few years now, again, pre-COVID, is because we know from the research that it has a profound and shocking impact on our health and longevity. People who are chronically lonely have a over 30% chance of dying early. They will get sicker, they will have more cognitive decline than people who are less lonely. It has a wicked impact on our emotional and our physical health. Loneliness is the equivalent of smoking 15 cigarettes a day in terms of what it does to our physical health, let alone our psychological health. So that's why loneliness, coming up to COVID, has been considered in epidemic proportions and highly problematic, because it actually will kill us in time. It will make us sicker, and along the way, it makes us more miserable. Now, after social distancing, after quarantining, after working from home, loneliness has been going up in really dramatic ways. We are social animals. We need touch. We need human touch. There are many, many people, significant proportions of the population, have been living alone and have not had human contact with another person, physical touch, for months. This is an unnatural situation for us, and one that is extremely distressing and taxing. Again, as I said, both physically and psychologically. And so these are conditions which are extremely concerning. The people who are living with people might have appreciated the fact that, okay, but at least I have a partner, or at least I have family, or at least I have roommates around me when this started. But 3 months into working from home and potential quarantines, those people are beginning to get a little tired. Already, and people are irritable, and people are having a really hard time being cooped up and confined. The workplace is a good example. Conferences are great because you get to interact with people. But the workplace is like that too. On the way to the meeting, you stop by this person's office, you pop your head into this cubicle, you stop in the break room, you have a drink of water with someone, you go out for a cigarette, you have coffee afterwards. There are so many touch points of social and human interaction during the day that we do not have when we're working virtually. Zoom meetings tend to be all business. And so you've lost all those touch points of human interaction, which again, add up and make us feel more connected, more seen, more a part of, and less lonely. So loneliness is something that we're all dealing with to some degree or another at this time. And hopefully things will improve as easing happens and we start coming out of COVID. But that's when the anxiety kicks in that will want to keep us away from people, even after we're allowed to be a little closer to them. And that will fortify the loneliness, which will make us then more hesitant and avoidant, which will increase anxiety. There's this whole dynamic that goes on that these things tend to ricochet from one to another. And the last thing I'm going to mention is relationships. Because relationships are being taxed right now. Partners, couples are having a hard time mostly because they've been cooped up together 24/7 for months. And they've had to work side by side and with the kids there or without the kids there, but the in-laws there. So tensions between couples are really high. Some couples might be doing well, but there are few. Most are tense. Most are having a hard time, not just because their relationship has been stressed, but because the individual stresses of loneliness, of loss, of grief, of anxiety, and all those things that we've been deprived of made us more irritable, more sharp. So we have a little less patience for our partners and our families and the people we live with. We have a little less patience to respond well or nicely or to ask them how they're doing because we're depleted. All this is the mix that goes in to the emotional state and the mental state that we are all in during and will be in as we come out of COVID. So those are the four mental health issues to consider. But here's the complication I promised. Unfortunately, the way things play out, these effects are highly staggered because some towns, certainly some cities, certainly some countries are experiencing things in a very different way than others. If you live in a rural area and the shutdowns haven't impacted you as much because you're still going to the grocery shop and you live on a farm so you can still be outdoors and you're still talking to your neighbors because there haven't really been many cases in your area, you have a very different experience than somebody who's living in the big city in an apartment building that they haven't really left it in 3 months. You know, we know that different areas are having easing happen at different rates. So some people right now, I'm from the United States, some people right now have life almost back to normal. While in New York City, where I'm based, life is incredibly unnormal. Even today, people are not back to work. Things are boarded up. Now they're protests, so, you know, it's even worse. So there's a real difference in the population, in people, and that can be a difference between siblings, between, you know, neighborhoods even, between what people's experience has been. Somebody who is quarantining alone is gonna come out of this after several months a much worse shape than somebody who's been at least among friends, had the ability to see other people in a social distanced way. Somebody who is an essential worker or whose spouse is a nurse or a doctor and has been on the front lines is going to have a very different experience than somebody who hasn't. So the other complication I'm throwing in there is the staggeredness of everything, that it's going to be hard to really know in terms of the businesses, in terms of clients, in terms of B2B, in terms of all of it, but certainly for communications, who you're communicating with, what their experience has been. But for everyone, the experience has been stress. For everyone, the experience has been anxiety provoking. For everyone, the coming out of COVID will have this dual intensity of really wanting to resume normal life as much as possible and being highly anxious about it. And I didn't even throw in any complications of a second wave happening when, or a peak happening again when eases happen, or second waves happening in the fall when flu season begins in the winter. In other words, we don't know when COVID will end. We don't know how many waves it will have. We don't know how much back and forth there will be. This is what's keeping everyone on edge. This is what's keeping everyone anxious. And we might emerge from this feeling, you know, like, oh, let's just pretend it's all over. And I know that from countries and areas in which they've had this kind of significant easing going on, that's been the instinct, especially of younger people, to feel like, okay, it's over. We've survived it. It's not over. We've survived it, but it's not over. And we don't know when it will be. And all of those things, and the tensions it creates, the anxieties it creates, the loneliness people are recovering from, the frayed relationships that have to be mended, the losses and that have to be grieved, all those are things to be considered given the nature, specific nature of the communications, the marketing, the efforts that you will be making to interact post-COVID. I'm going to end with one last quick statement, which is positive, because, you know, otherwise that was just horribly depressing. But here's the positive thing. The other thing we've been doing during this time is we've been building resilience, and we will all come out of this stronger from having been through it. Thank you.
Evet. Tekrar bendeyiz diye düşünüyorum. Yes. Thank you, Guy. It was great. And it's a different experience for all of us. But it was good. I enjoyed all this experience of online conferences, and I hope you enjoyed it as well. You used to get on the stage and talk to maybe thousands of people, and now you are again talking to thousands of people, but online. We have a couple of minutes, so I'm going to ask the audience if they have any questions. Actually, maybe we already did, I don't know. Sorunuz varsa soru aparatımızdan sorabilirsiniz şimdi ve ben de buradan Guy Winch'e sorunuzu yönlendirebilirim. Onu söylemiş olayım. So before we get any questions, I'm gonna just ask you a quick one. I mean, do you think we ever experienced anything like this in the human history? I'm just saying, obviously, like, not talking about the pandemic and all, like COVID-19, but I don't know, you can consider any other horrible experiences human beings experienced, which would, I mean, cause something similar emotions caused by something bad, let's say. I'm not sure if I could really say it properly, but what I'm saying...
No, but I understand the question. I understand the question. And this is what I was saying, that really the only true analogy here is the last World War. Because the last World War, and even the last World War, to be clear, did not impact the entire world. It's not that everyone was impacted. The world happened, the war happened mostly in Europe, in Asia, in the Pacific. And there were plenty areas in which people sent soldiers but were not impacted directly. But even that was a disruptive event that everyone was aware of and impacted by in some way. That's the last analogy we have. Nothing since then. And the world is a very different world today, because today we are actually feeling that we are going through something similar than people all over the world and other countries. And there's something that's bonding about it. It's something that's making us feel like we're all part of humanity, because the virus is attacking everyone, regardless of nationality, regardless of anything that might divide us. It's a great equalizer in that way. But it's disruptive in the same way the last world wars were disruptive. Mm-hmm. And nothing since then has been this disruptive or this impactful on the emotional or mental health of the globe as a whole.
Yeah, we have one question now. My colleagues, they just shared that with me now. Cheval Koç asked the question. I don't know from which company. Next time, if you can write down the company, it would be great. She's saying, what do you suggest to the brands in this period of time, and how should they really approach and treat their clients and customers? This is the question she's asking.
So look, I mean,
suggestions to brands. Yeah.
Yes. So look, it's a question I'm getting asked in the United States as well, given the Black Lives Matter protests and all of that. It's a time of great sensitivity in general. When people have been through something, they are more sensitive and they are more reactive and they are edgier, they're more irritable. And so, you know, brands have to consider that there's something that they have to take in mind about the current mood in general. There's something they have to take in mind about where, you know, like we've been through something very, very difficult. There's something in the communications, there's something in how you're positioning your brands that has to acknowledge the moment in some kind of way, even if it's briefly, because that's not where you want to stay. But there's some kind of regard you have to give, because it's a time where people can feel like you're ignoring something so profound that happened. It's problematic. So it's something brands have to find ways to address, even in their marketing and communications, which can be complicated given on the brand and given what those marketing and communication efforts are. But it's something that does have to be acknowledged in some way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm just checking if any more questions. One last question I want to ask, then we're going to finish this session. I mean, people, I mean, human beings, we usually get used to things so easily. Like in the first days of lockdown, we were all saying like, oh, how can we really finish all this? How long are we going to be at home and kind of things? And after, I don't know, maybe a month or something, we all got used to it. And actually, for myself, I was even happy at home. and now we are normalizing in Turkey. We are normalizing now, and some other parts of the world is happening. And now, when I go out and we have busy streets, people are going out for lunch or dinner. Obviously, they are really trying to keep their social distance. But I mean, I see this pattern that people will get used to things so easily. In my opinion, it's, I don't know, in like 20 days or 30 days, they just get used to things. But this is your expertise, so probably you're going to enlighten me about this thing. I mean, how long does it take for us to get used to things and really accept things? Probably your answer will help the brands, the companies, or I don't know, even for every single human being.
Mm. Look, we are very adaptable as a species. Mm-hmm. We adapt very, very quickly, but we adapt in our behaviors. Our behaviors are much quicker to adapt than our emotions. And just to make the point there, you might see people interacting in the street and everyone might be smiley and having a good time. I was in Turkey in February. I was in Istanbul in February. Maybe the streets look similar than they did back in February. I can assure you that if you're happily walking in the crowd in the streets and one person coughs very loudly, you will see people react in a very different way than they did in February. In other words, the reminder will be right there. The anxiety will be right there and right below the surface. The behaviors manifest might seem like, hey, we're back to normal. Isn't this great? We survived it. It's over. But that layer of tension, the apprehension, the anxiety, and the muscle memory emotionally of what we've been through will be very close to the surface. And so you don't get fooled by the fact that things look more normal. They will look normal way before they actually feel that way to the depths, in terms of our emotional experience, because all our reflexes emotionally are still going to be extraordinarily on edge. For quite a while. And if there's another surge, or if the flu season begins and people start coughing and they don't know what it is now, is this COVID, is this, you will see a big impact on people. So that's why it might look normal, and everybody would love for it to be. And we also have short memories. So maybe we'd like to pretend like, oh, you know, it's good. Now we're back to normal. I hardly remember what that was like. It's not the case. We do remember. We've been slightly, some more than slightly, but we've all been slightly traumatized by suddenly this falling on us, you know, out of the blue in such a dramatic, sudden, sharp way. We've not been through this kind of experience emotionally or mentally before. It will leave its scars, even if we're not aware of them. But at some point, we will become aware of them. Like I said, when someone starts coughing or you wake up with a fever and you're just not sure what it is, everything gets activated. So don't be fooled by the behavior. The emotions take much longer to adapt than our behavior does.
Thank you, Guy. It was great having you at our first online conference. Hopefully, in the future, in healthier times, we're gonna have you at a physical conference, and we're gonna meet face to face. Again, thanks for joining us. It was a pleasure for us welcoming you at Weber's Digital.
For me as well. Thank you so very much, and
thank
stay
you.
Healthy, everyone.
You too.